بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده. Dear respected viewers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to another brand new episode of the program entitled Towards the Origin. And to those, all of those who will be watching on our Channel S YouTube channel, Facebook page, and via the website live streaming. This is in fact our first episode of the year 2017. And the society that we live in, whether it be in Eastern or Western part of the world, there is always one thing we notice, that is, every human being will make some sort of resolution to themselves, or promise to themselves, or make a pledge to rectify or to abolish or to dispel the old unhealthy habits and replace it with something better. In the professional, corporate, commercial world, we do see it's all about setting up new targets, goals, aspiration, agendas, and so on and so forth. But one thing we do notice that is common across the board, whether it be in our personal, private, professional world, and that is, we discuss one thing very commonly, that is, how do we use things that is environmentally friendly, or a common phrase or word that we hear, it's all about go green, save the planet, save the earth, and so on. Now, as Muslims, we every single day nowadays, we do notice or we do listen or read articles about pollution, about the global warming, climate change, and everything related to the environmental issues. Now, as Muslims, how do we respond? Is there any Islamic approach or solution to it? And or we do know for a fact that the whole world will eventually come to an end. So do we do nothing? All of these and many more, inshallah, we'll be trying to discuss in our tonight's program. And therefore, our topic title is Islam and Environment. And to discuss this topic, we have with us a very renowned scholar who is the graduate from Al-Azhar University, Egypt, and the respected Khateeb and Imam of the famously known mosque, that is Regent's Park Mosque or London Islamic and Cultural Center, Shaykh Kazi Lutfur Rahman. Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
First of all, thank you very much for your valuable time in the studio.
You're more than welcome. It's my pleasure.
Jazakallah khair. And I would just like to start our discussion today in a slightly different way. We know that there are a lot of scientific institutions, researchers, including the NASA, that talk about the global warming, climate change, and things that are evidences based on the researchers published by those scientific, by the scientists. Now, my first question for today's program is there anything that is called as environmental ethics in Islam?
Yes, alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Wal aqibatu lil muttaqeen. Alhamdulillah, alladhi akmala lana deenana wa atamma alayna ni'matah wa radhiya lana al-islam deena. Allahumma radhina billahi rabba wa bil islam deena wa bi Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallama nabiyyan wa rasoola. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. إنك حميد مجيد. I testify that there is none worthy of worship except Allah, and He is one and He has no partners. And I also testify that Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, is the final messenger and slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah, the Almighty, He created human beings and He gave human beings a special certificate. He mentioned in the Holy Quran, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمْ, that indeed I have honored the children of Adam. I have honored the sons and children of Adam. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمْ. So mankind was given a special status, a special degree by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also He gave a very special certificate to the Ummah of Islam, Ummah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he said in the Holy Quran, كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله. So Allah the Almighty said in the Holy Quran that كنتم خير أمة, you've been created as the best of the nations. خير أمة, best of the nations. You've been created as the best of the nations. أخرجت للناس for the benefit of others. So we are an ummah, we're not an ummah of selfishness. Mm-hmm. We don't only benefit ourselves. We have been created to benefit others, to be positive and to be productive and to benefit and help others. أخرجت للناس for the benefit of the mankind. And not only mankind, for the benefit of everything that around us. Everything that around us. And what is our responsibilities? So Allah the Almighty, when He declared and when He witnessed that we are the best of the nations, He didn't leave us without any responsibilities. So He gave us some roles and responsibilities. So He said, تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. Your responsibilities will be enjoining what is right. You will advise people, you'll counsel people, you will tell people to do good things, but with hikmah wal-maw'idha al-hasana, with the wisdom and beautiful speech. And watanhawana anil munkar, and also you would forbid what is evil. So Allah the Almighty, He made the Ummah of Islam a special Ummah, special nation, according to the Quranic statement. After He declared that mankind itself has an honor, and Ummah of Islam has a special honor. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created us, He sent us to this world as responsibles. He didn't send us without any responsibilities.
Does it mean that He has sent us as a trustee?
Absolutely correct. So Allah the Almighty said in a very famous verse in the Holy Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, He says, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ, remember, Allah the Almighty spoke to angels, told the angels that I would like to send the people, Khalifa, to my earth. Mm-hmm. I would like to send Khalifa. Khalifa has actually several meanings according to the commentators of the Holy Quran. But the famous meanings are generations after generations. So Allah the Almighty will send generations after generations. خَلَائِف هو الذي جعلكم خَلَائِفَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. So Khalifa also means a representative of Allah the Almighty, someone who will implement the commandments of Allah on the earth. So the first Khalifa was Sayyidina Adam alayhi wa ala nabiyyina as-salam. And then followed by Sayyidina Adam, we had many, many khulafa. And even in Islam, we had many, many khulafa. So as human beings, we are all of us, we're representing our Lord, our Creator, Allah the Almighty. In a famous prophetic statement, hadith of our beloved Prophet Muhammad salawatu rabbi wa salamu alayhi, which is in the authority of Ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu anhu, قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. Every one of you is a shepherd. Every one of you is a shepherd. And you will be questioned about your responsibility. So when he said shepherd, he means the responsible. Every one of you is a shepherd of your flock. And you will be questioned about your flock on the day of reckoning, day of resurrection. So each and every single of us in this world, and especially when we claim to be Muslims, we are responsible. We have responsibilities. We have duties in this world. So كلكم راعٍ وكلكم مسؤولٌ عن رعيتي. Then Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, proceed by saying فالأمير راعٍ. So a ruler, a leader, is a shepherd. A ruler is responsible. فالأمير راعٍ وهو مسؤول عن رعيته. And he will be questioned on the day of judgment about his responsibilities. How he ruled. Did he establish justice, fairness in this world? Did he establish equality? Did he treat people equally? All those things will be questioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Okay, that's a very great point that you have mentioned regarding the ruler, or regarding the person who will be leading a group, or who will be leading the country. Now, what is it regarding to the person who leads a family, like a fatherly figure?
Yes.
Will he be classified among that?
Absolutely beautiful question. Your question will be answered in the hadith, inshallah. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, والرجل راع على أهله وهو مسؤول عن رعيته. And a man is shepherd, a husband, and a manager of the house. A man of the house, he is shepherd, in his house and he'll be questioned about his responsibilities, how he took care of his family, what did he do? Did he give them the beautiful and correct teachings, beautiful tarbiyah? Did he look after his children? Did he nourish his children physically and spiritually? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask on the Day of Judgment. Then not only that, وَالْمَرْأَةُ رَاعِيَةٌ عَلَى بَيْتِ زَوْجِهَا وَهِيَ مَسْؤُولَةٌ عَنْ رَاعِيَتِهَا. And a woman and a wife, a woman is responsible. She is a shepherd in the household of her husband. And she will be questioned about her responsibilities on the Day of Resurrection. So she will be questioned about her responsibilities. And then Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he conclude the hadith by saying, أَلَا كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُولًا عَنْ رَعِيَتِي. Indeed, every one of you, Allah, every one of you are responsible, are shepherds, and you will be questioned about your flocks on the Day of Judgment. So we understand when we claim to be Muslims, it's not just that we are Muslim and that's it, there's nothing that we should do. No, we have lots of things, lots of responsibilities, and through these we built our akhirah. Al-dunya mazra'atun lil-akhirah. This world actually is a cultivation for the next world. So we have tremendous, or we've got numerous responsibilities in this world. Now, as a responsible, we are actually responsible for everything that around us.
Before I move on to the responsible element of our discussion today, there is one element that you have briefly touched upon, and you have very nicely said about the advice given with hikmah. Mm-hmm. Now, the concern that we see, or the question that I have, is a lot of time, or a lot of people have, or our audiences, in fact, will have questions that a lot of the time we see particular figures coming on media platforms or giving lectures mm-hmm. about something mm-hmm. that they know that they personally do not follow themselves. Mm-hmm. Now, what would you say, or what does Islam say about giving advice mm-hmm. about something that personally that person who's giving the advice or suggestion does not follow?
Yeah, this is a problem, and it's mentioned in the Holy Quran. Allah the Almighty said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لِمَ تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. Or you who believe, why do you say something that you do not do, you do not practice? And naturally, if someone doesn't do something by himself and he advises other people, then people will not actually be influenced, or people will not be inspired by his advice or his speech, because simply he's not practicing. But every one of us, when we give speeches, we try our best to implement ourselves, inshallah. But also we admit that we are all human beings and correct. We have mistakes. But every one of us, we are trying our best to get to that highest position in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
My second question to you would be, now we do hear in a lot of khutbas that our ulama, our imams, khatibs, they do mention about, say for example, the basic element in the wudu area, not to waste enough water. Mm-hmm. Be conscious, be careful mm-hmm. about how we use, even though we know, alhamdulillah, the country that we live in yep. Masajis, the water is very plenty.
Yes.
But even the small element about using the water for the purpose of wudu also needs to be very measured.
Now, yes.
Is there any relationship yep. with this moderate use of water, or careful use of water, or conscious use of water, with environment in Islam?
Thank you very much. Jazakallah khair. Yes, of course. Water is one of the greatest ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah the Almighty said in the Holy Quran, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you start counting the favors and gifts of Allah the Almighty upon you, then you can never finish the count. That's how much ni'mah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us. But out of all this ni'mah, water is one of the most precious gifts from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we were speaking about environment earlier, environment, some people might think, what is environment? So environment literally means that everything that around us, so trees, grass, water, animals, insects, people, human beings, the weather, so whatever is around us, whatever we live in, is environment. So things that around us are environment, and that include human beings, animals, trees, plants, water.
So in short, all the living things, yes, the nature across us.
Yes, environment. Now, when we talk about water, water is fundamental nature.
That's the second word for life.
Yes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Holy Quran, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ, that I have created everything from the water. Our origin is water. Our root as human beings, we actually come from a drop of fluid. So our origin is water. So water is a very great ni'mah of Allah. But unfortunately, we see in our society, many people tend to waste water. And I see sometimes people having baths. And when they come to bath, subhanAllah, they are filling up the taps one
just
after
to add
another.
A bit, the shower system that we have, yes, filling up the bathtub.
Yes, yes.
Now, how do we discuss? How do we deal with it? I remember
my father, Allah rahimhu, he used to say that when you have bath, take the water on the bucket, and use the water from the bucket. You know, take the water from the bucket so that you know how much the water you're spending. If you take from shower from the tap, then you may not be you can't realize how much the water has been used. So he used to say, take it from the bucket. So water is a great ni'mah of Allah. I lived in Middle East, and I know how sometimes people go through the crisis of water. We even used to sometimes wait for hours. Like water used to get cut off, and no waters for
not
hours.
Only in the Middle East, in South Asian countries, in African countries, yes, where we have seen a lot of on the TV, we do see a lot of because of the inavailability or insufficient water. What happens to the land?
Yes.
What happened to the animals?
People literally queue up for hours and hours.
Indeed.
To actually get some just a couple of liters of water, and subhanAllah, how many flushes we do in this country? How much? You know, generally we waste water. We tend to waste water. But look at Prophet Muhammad salawat rabbi wa salamu alayhi. He put everything in context, everything in balance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَأَقِيمُ الْوَزْنَ بِالْقِسْطِ وَلَا تُخْسِرُ الْمِيزَانِ. Establish the balance in this world. You're living as a balanced ummah of wasat, moderation. So, وَأَقِيمُ الْوَزْنِ, you know, create and establish a wazn, tawazun, balance. وَلَا تُخْسِرُ الْمِيزَانِ, and do not destroy this wazan, do not destroy this balance. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is teaching us to be moderate when we come to spend our water, one of the greatest ni'mah of Allah, when we make wudu. So listen to this great, beautiful statement of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, an Abdullah ibn Amr, anna Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam marra bi Sa'd. On the authority of great companion Abdullah ibn Amr, he says that Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he was passing by a great companion called Sa'd. So Sa'd was making wudu, ablation. He was making wudu. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam said, ma hadha sarf? Ma hadha sarf ya Sa'd? What is this extravagance? What is this wasting of water, O Sa'd? What are you doing? Why are you wasting too much water while you're making wudu? فَقَالَ أَفِي الْوُضُوءِ إِسْرَافِ. So then Prophet Sa'd, was curious and he was surprised when Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that, why are you wasting water? Because he thought he's making wudu, he's worshipping Allah, because wudu is a form of worship. So he is literally worshipping Allah while he's making wudu. So he thought that the spending or consuming water, it's not a problem in wudu. So he says, أَفِي الْوُضُوءِ إِسْرَافِ. So he said, is there an extravagance? Is there a wasting in wudu? So Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, Na'am wa in kunta ala nahrin jar. Yes, even if you're making wudu on in front of a flowing river. So you've got a river in front of you, and the river is flowing, water is continuously coming. Even then, we should look after and we shouldn't consume water excessively, because it's a great ni'mah of Allah, the Almighty. Also, I'd like to relate. Sometimes we have a problem that when we go to some places and we say that we have paid for it. For example, we may be in a hotel.
Paid for the service. Yeah,
paid for the service. So we tend to waste the electricity. We tend to waste water because we just think that we paid for it. But remember, you have been given the trust from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even though we pay, but if you are truthful and trustworthy, and you look after the resources that come from Allah, because water comes from Allah, and even everything, actually, the root of everything is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even electricity goes to water. Everything comes from Allah. So we take care of the resources that come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the responsibility of a Muslim. So Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, وَإِنْ كُنْتَ عَلَىٰ نَهْرٍ جَارٍ. Even if you are making wudu in front of a flowing river, do not waste the water. because this is a great sin. Allah the Almighty said in Surah Al-Isra as well, a general statement regarding the extravagance or wasting anything. So he says in the Holy Quran, Surah Al-Isra, وَلَا تُبَذِّرْ تَبْذِيرًا وَلَا تُبَذِّرْ تَبْذِيرًا. Do not waste, do not do extravagance. إِنَّ الْمُبَذِّرِينَ كَانُوا إِخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ. And he says that indeed the people who waste the na'am, the resources of Allah the Almighty, they're the brothers of demons, shaytan. إِنَّ الْمُبَذِّرِينَ كَانُوا إِخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ. So we can understand that taking care of the water, saving them, protecting them is our responsibility as believers in this world, because we just have to use accordingly, according to the requirement and according to the need. And then it doesn't matter even though we paid. We may say, oh, I've paid the bill, so I have the right to, you know, use the water. No, remember that when you save and protect the environment, someone else may be benefited. We never know. And through this, maybe we'll be, inshallah, eligible for the salvation in the hereafter.
Okay, there's a connecting question that I'm very much conscious about a minute of time that I've got before I go to the break. Just a connecting question, the way you've said, just to make sure that audience understand in proportion that we are not against, Islam is not against the luxury if Allah blesses you through halal sources.
Definitely.
But it's just what I gather is you're trying to convey the message here is whatever blessing Allah has given us through the halal sources, we have to utilize it in moderation, not in excess.
Absolutely correct.
So is that?
Of course, because also stinginess isn't something allowed in Islam. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made du'a. He said, "Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-bukhl wal-jubn." He made take refuge from Allah the Almighty to protect him from the stinginess, miserliness. So he said, bukhul is something bad. It's a disease.
So it's frowned upon in Islam.
Yes. So stinginess, you know, some people they are too harsh. Even if you just use a little bit, say, oh, don't, you know. So we have this, some people on the other side, those who have the problems of bukhul. But no, Islam puts, as I said, everything as balanced in moderation, you know, al-wasatiyya.
So in short, it means we don't need to be at the end of the either of the spectrum, but rather in moderation,
inshallah,
in between the middle path.
According to our need, we need to use. We need to, even when we come to eat, when we come to consume, when we come to spend, we do everything according to the need. And no excessive and no wasting.
And that's one of the reasons that even today the health, for the people who are in the health profession, doctors and so on, they also advise the obesity or the health issues are related of our excessiveness, our indulgence in the food that we are not supposed to intake. And now, alhamdulillah, they're also adopting the Islamic principle of the one-third of food, water and the free
SubhanAllah,
space.
SubhanAllah, SubhanAllah. Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, whatever he said, it seems to be that it goes absolutely with the medical advice. And not only this, it's better than, because Prophet Islam, his advices are far before advanced than the modern
technology,
you know, technology and medical advices. So yes, many people, I mean, when we actually follow the prophetic guidelines, we see everything is in track. You start from Salat al-Fajr. Imagine if you pray Salat al-Fajr on time, and then you come home, you have some breakfast, and you do your dhikr, and then you do your tilawah, recitation of the Holy Quran, and while you're going to masjid, you're having some exercise, because maybe some of us, we eat late, you know, that problem.
And the morning exercise is one of the most beneficial to the health.
Sometimes we have to walk for 10, 15 minutes to the masjid, so we're getting, mashallah, good exercise. So yes, it completely goes with the, you know, teaching medical advices.
And the balanced nature of the human
being. One other thing I'd like to mention, Brother Qamar, also we have, I have observed that we have people in our society tend to waste a lot of tissues. And the tissue, the root of the tissue goes back to the trees, as far as I believe.
Yeah, I'll come to that, inshallah, about the trees, inshallah, after the short break. It's just we're running out of the time.
Already,
but inshallah,
the break,
stay with your thought, but inshallah, after the break, we'll be discussing continue to discuss that particular subject. My dear viewers, we have heard the discussion about Allah has sent us as Khalifa in this world, a trustee in this world, to look after everything that is around us. And the other aspect that we have learned and discussed, even if we have a river at our disposal, still we should be very much conscious and aware of how much of water we utilize. These are a teaching from the prophetic tradition that enable us today to be more conscious citizen and human being, looking at the problems and the troubles that we have with the natural resources. Inshallah, we'll be continuing our discussion after the short break. Do stay tuned with us, and we'll be back right after a short break. Wassalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the last segment of our today's episode. And our today's topic title is Islam and Environment. In our first segment, we've been listening to the discussion that the Shaykh briefly touched upon. And that is, number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent us in this world as a khalifa, the trustee of the earth. And the second thing we've heard and our Shaykh discussed is regarding the usage or constitution of water. We were discussing about the plantation, but before I discuss about plantation, there are other elements that we need to take into account, the discussion that the Shaykh had, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might bless us bounties, blessings through His mercy, but that does not mean we utilize it in a way that displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should always be concerned and conscious about things that we have and evaluate that people who do not have it, and then compare ourselves. How fortunate are we to have those blessings living in the first world country? If not too far, let's compare ourselves with people living in our country of origin, whether it be subcontinent, Africa, or any part of the world that are underdeveloped. And inshallah, then we will realize that how much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with the small ni'mah that we might take it for granted. But in reality, they are the biggest bounties blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, Shaykh, you did touch upon the water issue, and there is a particular element that we have studied, and we know that there are some small processes that we can easily reverse. Now, for an instance, to reverse the defrostation that's happening is by planting more plants across the maybe the place, our gardens, the way we live, our boundaries or lands or assets that we have, whether it be in this country or in our country of origin. Now, is there any specific or direct mention about plantation in Islam?
Jazakumullah khairan. Yes, again, trees, plants, flowers, are vegetations, are another great ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We benefit a lot, tremendously, from trees, from plants, from nature. Probably one of the main things that we depend on trees, which is oxygen.
And just to touch upon, you did slightly touch upon the tissue, and you were trying to link it with the trees.
Yes, so I'll come to that point. JazakAllah for the reminder. So oxygen and the source of oxygen is trees, many of us know. So trees, plantations, vegetations are also another great ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah the Almighty sent us to this world. Remember, we said that we are responsible for the protection, for the safety and security of everything around us, not only human beings, but also trees. We are obliged to take care of our trees, our plants, our nature around us. As I said, remember, كلكم راعٍ وكلكم مسؤولٌ عن رعيتي. We are responsible for everything that around us. So we as Muslims, we have the responsibility to take care of our environment. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he disliked any kind of assault on trees or cutting the trees unnecessarily without any need. Not only that, but also Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, he encouraged the Muslims highly to plant the trees. Look at this beautiful hadith of Prophet Muhammad salawatu rabbi salamu alayhi, when the authority of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, an nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam qal, ma min muslimin yaghrisu gharasan aw yazra'u zar'an فيأكل منه إنسان أو طير أو بهيمة إلا كانت له صدقة. Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, said that whenever a believer plants a tree, whenever a believer he plants a tree or sows a crop, whenever plants a tree or sows a crop, then anyone, any human being eats from it, benefits from that tree. Through any means, benefits from that tree. فَيَأْكُلُ مِنْهُ, eating, or maybe benefiting, you know, benefit themselves through other ways, he will get the reward of charity.
Whether it be the person, a man or a woman.
Yeah, a man or a woman, yes. Whoever, any Muslim or Muslimah, whoever does plants a tree and then or sows a crop, then every time a human being will eat from it, whether a Muslim or non-Muslim, he will get a portion of a percentage of reward, a reward of charity.
Quick question to that. Mm. When you say who will eat with it, are you talking about those who have planted or other neighbors,
other people,
or the villages?
Other people, anybody that benefits. People of the community, people of society, neighbors, whoever benefit from it, any insan will benefit from it. The person who planted, he will get the reward. A charity, reward of charity. SubhanAllah. Does anybody imagine that our religion is so vast and profound that we have so many different numerous sources of rewards? And that's the reason why Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah, he mentioned actually a chapter in Riyadh Salihin saying that a chapter on acquiring rewards from many different numerous sources. So Islam is vast and we can get rewards from so many different ways. So when we plant a tree, we literally get reward. But the intention has to be for Allah. Because there's a principle, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. Actions of a believer is judged according to intention. So our intention is for Allah, then every time someone eats from that tree, or benefits somehow, even from the shade of the tree, ظِل of the tree, yes, he will get reward from it. And then you have not only human beings, but also طَيِّر, any bird, any animal or bird benefits from it, then he will get reward. Our behemoth animals or birds, whenever they benefit or eat from that tree, that person will get reward of a charity. And I remember in another narration, Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said that even if someone steals from the tree, the person who plants, he will get reward of charity as well. Even because of if someone steals from it.
So when you say stealing, is it something, now there's two elements to it. A, doing it with the intention that causing loss to someone else.
Yeah.
Or, say for an instance, accidentally taking it off.
Maybe a tree was actually planted in a specific area and it's known that
it's a
private area. It's owned by some individuals. And that person comes and just takes it, a fruit or an apple or a mango, takes it, steals it. Then still, the rewards won't be missed. The reward will be given to the person who actually planted. So you can imagine, we are doing so many things in this world and we don't even realize that we're getting reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With regards to the plantation, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in another statement, he says on the authority of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in qamati sa'a, if the day of judgment is about to occur, it's about to take place, so it's just there, the hours. وَفِي يَدِي أَحَدِكُمْ فَسِيلًا. And some of you have the fasila, like a plant in your hand. So you might be having something in your hand.
A seed
or a plant, small plant in your hand. Prophet ﷺ said, if you can plant it, if you can put it, if you can sow it before the Day of Judgment takes place. Comes. Mm-hmm. So you can see Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we can understand two things from this hadith. Number one, that we need to produce in this world. We need to be productive. Even though Qiyamah is about to take place, but we still need to build the world. You know, ta'mir. We need to do the ta'mir of this world, building and constructing the world. Without obviously putting the hearts into the world. Meaning we construct the world, but our hearts are connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we are constructing the dunya while we're constantly in attachment and connection of Allah, the Almighty.
Now, there's a supplementary question to that. Mm-hmm. Now, as Muslim, and many faith school agrees on this fundamental fact that one day the whole world will eventually come to an end. Mm-hmm. When it is a known fact, regardless of how much we look after the dunya, some might have a question, what's the point of looking after the dunya when it's eventually we know that
exactly
the end of
yes,
the dunya will
yes,
be there?
Yes, many Muslims, we have this mentality that because we leave this world, so what's the point of doing certain things? But I remember a statement of great scholars, they said that اعمل للدنيا كأنك تعيش أبدا. Work for the world as if you're going to live in this world forever. work for this dunya as if you're going to live in this world, live in this world forever. وَعْمَلْ لِلْآخِرَةِ كَأَنَّكَ تَمُوتُ غَدًا. And work for the akhirah as if you're going to die tomorrow. So work for the dunya as if you're going to live in this world forever. And work for akhirah, for the hereafter, as if you're going to leave the world tomorrow.
Such a beautiful message there, just by replacing two words, work and live.
Yes.
And we have unfortunately replaced the word, and we have made the dunya more like living than working.
Absolutely correct. So we make actually our target the dunya, but the correct understanding is that we do everything. Sometimes some people say, oh, if you're religious, so why are you doing certain things in
correct.
Dunya? Like, why are you so much involved in the worldly things?
And to add a bit more to this, like, for instance, we have a certain concept within our community, within maybe people from the subcontinent, I would say, that if they see a religious people owning a luxury car or luxury houses, as if like it's been deemed upon that you should, if you're religious, you shouldn't be having or doing these kind of things, even though they are doing it from the halal source after fulfilling the zakat and due rights.
I mean, there is a hadith also, I don't remember exact word, but إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَنْعَمَ عَلَى عَبْدٍ يُرِيدُ أَنْ يَرَى أَثَرَ نِعَمْهِ فِيهِ أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. The hadith actually goes like, if Allah the Almighty favors upon someone with his ni'mah, then he want to see the athar, the effects of that ni'mah in him. So someone's like, Allah gave him so much, but he is just like, he's wearing ripped clothes, the ripped, you know,
the stinginess,
yes, stinginess, miserliness. But however, if someone does certain things out of the humbleness and to be in the state of always like humbleness, then there is no harm as long as he doesn't order others to do it. He doesn't force others to do it. So we have got two status here, that someone, he is rich, he's got everything, but he prefers to be live in a very lower
low
condition,
profile. Low profile,
It's okay as long as he doesn't go and tell others, you have to be like that as well.
Okay.
Do you understand?
And the other question connecting to that part would be, does not Allah says, وَمَا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ
فَحَدِّثْ. Yes, so that verse, it talks about if Allah gives you any ni'mah, then you're allowed to share the good news with other people as long as you don't have any pride or arrogance.
Okay, the condition for that is do it within measure if Allah has given the means, but do it with
moderately,
humbleness, but no arrogance
and humbleness,
or ignorance.
That's the condition. You may be riding a good car, all these things, but you have to still remain humble. You have to still remain in the condition that you have to think that, you know, the selflessness, that, you know, I'm not better than anybody in this world, especially amongst the Muslims. Always feel that, you know, Muslims, the people around me better than me. So when we have that mentality, we can remain always humble.
Okay, another connecting question to that would be the last bit of that particular subject that you have touched upon, is that you did mention about Allah will give reward if the intention is correct. Now, the intention is to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but at the same time, I have my business. It's a fruit or plantation business, whatever it is. Now, the intention is right, but even though I did it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the secondary is for business purpose, will still Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward us for that?
Yes, because business, again, if it's done for the sake of Allah, it's a reward. Okay. Prophet ﷺ said that the businessman, the truthful, trustworthy businessman will be resurrected with Siddiqeen, you know, with the greatest of the believers. They will be resurrected on the Day of Judgment as long as they're honest and they're truthful in their business and they do according to the prophetic
principles
teachings
of Islam.
You know, many of us actually, when we come to business, they say, oh, we're doing business, forget Islam. I know there are difficulties, there are
challenges.
A lot of challenges, but we still have to try our best.
فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُ. The basic guidelines
are there. Yeah, fear Allah as much as you can in a condition where you can't do certain things. But we have to still look after the Sharia guidelines when we do our business.
Great.
We have one more point, I think, animals.
Just before the animal thing now, we know about during Qurbani time, we know that how we have to look after a particular animal before we slaughter.
Good.
There are a lot of guidelines there we do notice regarding the sharpness of the knife, the facing of the animal, the other animal shouldn't be seeing it, the cruelness should be out. Yet we do see constantly on the media the halal, somehow the critics of Islam, they propagate that the halal method of slaughtering is somehow inhumane or
cruel
or it harms the animal. Now, how does or what does Islam specifically talk about apart from slaughtering, but is there anything direct teaching that Islam talks about animals?
Yes, so talking about animals, as I said, that we are, as believers, we are obliged to be kind, gentle, and soft and lenient with everything around us. And when it comes to animals, many of us, we don't even think the animals are something that we should take care of. I've seen people in some of the Muslim countries when we travel, that people give so much burden to animals, the animal can't even take the burden. Not only that, people beat the animals up so much.
Yeah, abuse, we do see that.
Yeah, beat them up continuously. But we have to look at our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. What did he say? Look, there's a concept in Islam called the concept of ihsan. Ihsan is the highest degree of faith. So you've got Islam, and then we've got Iman, and then we've got Ihsan. So Islam is the primary level. Islam is the primary level. Then we've got Iman is the secondary level. And Ihsan is the highest level. Ihsan has several meanings. It has got the top meaning is the excellence in everything. So Muslim is excellent in everything. Excellence. It also can mean the compromising. Being kind, being tolerant, being gentle. So Allah Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said in the hadith, إن الله كتب الإحسان على كل شيء. Indeed, Allah the Almighty, He wrote excellence, ihsan in everything. And He said, when you even come to slaughter your animals, فَأَحْسِنُ الذَّبْحَ. When you come to slaughter your animals, do ihsan to your animals. Make sure your knives are sharp and sharp enough that they don't get harmed or they don't get hurt
when
they're being slaughtered.
What about when you are looking after them, like when you talked about shepherd?
Yes, yes. Now, there are animals which are halal, and of course we take care of them. But there are animals that are not halal for us, but we still have to take care of them. So Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said in the hadith, that دَخَلَتِ الْمَرْأَ النَّارِ. A woman, she was eligible for the fire of hell. She entered into the fire of hell. A woman entered into the fire of hell. دخلت المرأة النار في هرة. Why was she admitted to the fire of hell? Because she had a cat that she would tie the cat every day. She tied the cat. فلم تطعمها. And she never gave the food to the cat. Never gave food to the cat. وَلَمْ تَدَعَهَا تَأْكُلْ مِنْ حِشَاشِ الْأَرْضِ. And she never set the cat free to go and search for the sustenance, food from the vermin of the earth. Now, you can see a lady didn't give the food, tied the cat. She was cruel and she was oppressing a cat. And she tied the cat, and because of that reason, she was admitted to the fire of hell. You can understand that taking care of animals, it's a great responsibility. On the other hand, we can see a lady who was entitled for the fire of hell, and she was given the certificate of hell. But when she saw one day a dog was really thirsty, a dog, look, taking care of the animals, a dog isn't halal as a food in Islam. And also, it's disliked in some ways, but we still can use and benefit from the dogs if it's for beneficial purposes such as security and safety,
or guide dogs.
Yes, but that dog was thirsty, and that lady, she thought to herself that, why don't I just feed some water to that dog? So what she did, she didn't have anything, to a bucket or anything to take the water out, so she took her sandals off. Or shoes off, and she got some water out from a well, and she fed that water to that dog with the intention of protecting the animal of Allah the Almighty, and therefore she was granted and she was given the certificate of Jannah. She was admitted to the Jannah. So many of us know these great prophetic statements. But generally speaking, that we need to take care of our environment. Now we've got a few points to cover.
Yeah, I'm just concerned about my conscience, about our timing,
yes.
Inshallah.
Now,
I want to find out, before you give your last thought, I mean, I know there are a lot of challenges in the Muslim world, and even we have a lot of challenges living in the western part of the world, but alhamdulillah, we're still living in much better position than people who are facing the atrocities or challenges, alhamdulillah, for that. Now, being conscious about that, is there anything that we can do to contribute in our society? Is there any advice that you can give us, even though they might look or appear small, but if done collectively?
Now, very, very important, and I think we have a few minutes left only. First of all, we need to understand that Allah is beautiful. There is an attribute, sifa of Allah, that He's Jameel. إن الله جميل ويحب الجمال. Allah the Almighty is beautiful and He loves everything that is beautiful. What do we understand from that statement, prophetic statement, that we need to make sure that we ourselves are beautiful? Our family, our households, our societies, our environment is beautiful and clean. We all know that Islam is a religion of cleanliness. So Prophet Muhammad said, "An-nazafatu min al-iman." The cleanliness is from the faith. At-tuhuru shatru al-iman. Even though the sanad of the hadith has a little bit of weakness, but still the meaning is completely correct. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "At-tuhuru shatru al-iman." The cleanliness is half of the faith. Now, if Islam is a religion of cleanliness, that we make sure our environment, our societies, our houses are clean, neat, and tidy. Now, we have habits amongst people. We have habits amongst some of our people. So one thing that we see, some people keep on spitting everywhere, spitting on the streets, here and there, throwing the phlegms. Manushya sef, idik shidik de falain, khash falain.
Especially when people have tobacco in their mouth.
Falain. Sometimes we think amra mone kori je fik dekhilo mone kori amra bangali ra kotha ichi. So we throw certain things from our mouth on the public streets, in public places,
or even waste.
Yeah, yes. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in hadith, and that's very important. He says, "Uridat alayya a'mal ummati," that the deeds of my ummah were presented to me, good ones and the bad ones. So the deeds of my ummah were presented to me, good ones and bad ones. And he said, amongst the good ones, فَوَجَدْتُ فِي مَحَاسِنِ أَعْمَالِهَا الْأَذَى يُمَاطُ عَنِ الطَّرِيقِ. He said, amongst the good deeds I found, the highest one, the best one, is the removal of harmful objects from the streets. Removal of harmful objects from the streets. Glasses, piece of glasses can cause harm, people. Hazardous. We have banana peel. We have got things like thorns, branches of trees. Sometimes can cause major accidents and damage. So Prophet ﷺ said, removing harmful object from the street is one of the branches of faith. And he says the best of the deeds, good deeds, is that removal of harmful environment, protecting the environment. Then he said, وَوَجَدْتُ فِي مَسَاوِي أَعْمَالِهَا النُّخَاعَ تَكُونُ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ لَا تُدْفَنُ. And he said, amongst the bad ones, I've seen the phlegms and spit unburied in public places, and especially in the masjid. So we can see that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he completely disliked chucking things here and there. And not only that, also Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, relieving oneself in public. He says, like, this calls curses of Allah, and also in the shade of the trees, relieving oneself. All those things are against the teaching of Islam, and because they cause harm in the environment.
Jazakallah khair for your beautiful nasiha. It's been very beneficial, and I would like to thank you once again for your valuable time and being here in this studio.
Barakallah fikum. Thank you very much.
My dear viewers, with this we have come to the end of today's program. What we have learned, these small changes can make a big difference. And things that we have spoken about, is such as, for example, the animal right, which the world today talks about. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed it in the Quran or the prophetic tradition, but it was there 1400 years ago. Now we need to be the true ambassador of Islam. And how can we do that? It's by following and implementing the teaching of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And finally, I would like to say, if we follow the path of excellence, inshallah, success will follow by default.
Inshallah.
Thank you very much for being here, and thank you very much for watching us at home or from wherever you're watching. For those who will be watching, inshallah, later on YouTube channel, on our Facebook page, which is from Channel S, inshallah, if you do have any feedback, do leave those feedback for us, inshallah, to take a note of it and to better our future programs. With this, we have come to the end of our tonight's program. We hope you have found the program educational, informative, and inshallah, till we meet again, سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته.
جزاك الله خير.